Hey y'all, I'm here with my girl Shelby. I can't pronounce her last name properly, so I'm
Heintzelman, Shelby Heintzelman.
Shelby Heintzelman, one of my really good friends and also just a resident bad A. We freaking love her, she's incredible. But Shelby and I are gonna talk to you guys a little bit today about something that we both feel really strongly about, which is stability through the core and how important that is. Would you say you see this like quite a bit whenever you're teaching like yoga, primal movement, or any sort of coaching?
Absolutely. I think it's one of the top things that people have a hard time really maintaining throughout every exercise that they do. So
yes. And it's really like, it sounds stupid because you're like core is the core, but it's so true. Like it's a fundamental portion to make sure that everything else you do is pain-free, safe, you name it. So one of the big things, and we've both kind of studied somebody named Stuart McGill, he's awesome. If you don't know who he is, go look him up. But one of the big things that they talk about is proximal stiffness will create distal athleticism. So what that means is basically you're gonna create a strong foundation through your body, and it's gonna protect the spine, and it's gonna allow for the energy to be properly displaced through your body so you can perform movements well, and you can perform them at your highest ability, right? So your brain is sending the proper waves to where it needs to go, and you're not sending out all these things different ways because you're not able to stay strong through your core.
Right. So then it really allows you to properly load the body. Whenever you have a nice and strong core, it really allows you to properly execute the movement with more efficiency and things like that.
So. Right. Yeah, exactly. And like your spine is made to move. We walk with it. You can dance. You can do all the crazy things. But when it comes to bearing load and when it comes to doing exercise, you really want to have that stiff, safe, strong spine. So that's going to help you bear load all the way through and bear it safely. So we're going to show you three moves that we really like. They're really good to do every single day, especially before a training session or maybe a class. And they really don't take that long. You can do them at home. You can do them in front of a TV while you're watching Netflix, whatever you want to do, but they can help decrease back pain. They can help really get other muscles fired up the way that they need to be. And really there's just a ton of benefits to it. I personally do them all the time. I know we've done them together. They're awesome. And honestly, if you do them right, they're actually kind of challenging.
They are. Yeah. They really help you build the endurance that you really need to sustain through your exercising, whatever that may be.
So. Right. That's a really good point too. A strong core is really important, but having endurance through your core muscles is huge, because if your core can turn on but it doesn't stay on, it's not going to help you a ton. You need to be able to keep it on the whole time, maybe throughout the entirety of the day, and it'll really keep you safe and keep you strong. Okay, so Shelby's going to demonstrate the three exercises for us. These are called the Big Three. Stuart McGill, you know, came up with this method, and it's phenomenal. I really love it. We've really been implementing it with some of my clients and classes. It's been great. The first one is called the McGill Curl Up. So you're gonna have one knee bent, one leg straight, and you're gonna put your hands under your lower back basically to provide a spacer. So you wanna be able to kind of drive your spine into your hands, but we don't wanna go all the way to the mat because then we're actually creating a stretch reflex. So from here, once we've got the stomach and the core nice and activated, we're gonna lift up and kind of hover the head and shoulders over the mat, but still keeping the shoulder blades back. You're gonna hold it for like 2 seconds or so, and then you're gonna come right back down, right? And when you come down, you'll notice she's releasing a little bit, but not all the way, right? So we're keeping that tension there, and then we're gonna come right back up. Mm-hmm. And then you would just go right back down. Once you've done about five on this side, you would actually switch which leg is bent, and then you'll get about the same on each side, five and five. If this has any sort of shoulder pain for you, or if you can't do it without any pain, you can modify by putting your hands up here on your chest and do the exact same movement. We would probably put like a towel under her lower back again, just so she's not pushing down so far that she's activating a stretch reflex. Shelby's amazing though, and she can do it without a towel. So that's one thing that you can do if you're having some shoulder pain with that. Okay, so our next exercise we're gonna do is called the bird dog, which most people that I see do this wrong. I'm gonna say that probably 90% of people that I see do it incorrectly. First thing you're gonna do is you're gonna get your knees right underneath your hips. Wrists are gonna be stacked underneath the shoulders, spine is nice and strong, and abs are engaged. Notice too that her head is in neutral. She's not looking up too high or tucking her chin too low, keeping it right in neutral. You're gonna take opposite hand, opposite leg, and you're gonna take them off, and you're really gonna keep the abs nice and tight here, and you're not shifting your weight around, so she's not leaning onto her plant leg. You'll hold it for about 4 to 5 seconds, and then you're gonna squeeze and pull it all back in. Then you would do that same side again until you get all of your reps. I would say about 5 reps on each side. A big thing here is though watching that shift. Sometimes you might not even feel it until you're coming back down. That leg should just glide right back down on the mat. It shouldn't be a huge drop. Now I'm gonna have Shelby show us some not so great reps. So she's gonna extend out and she's gonna arch the back, which is something you don't wanna see. And she's also gonna shift her weight into her plant leg, which is something you don't wanna do. Okay, and then you'll pull it right back down. So you'll see there was a lot of movement in the finishing portion of that, which is something you don't want, a huge indicator that you've done something wrong. There's also a modification for this. If you feel any sort of pain, you can do it standing. We'll talk about that at another date. Okay, so the third and final exercise here is we're gonna actually just do a side plank. Pretty standard, most people know how to do this one, but we wanna make sure you do it properly. One big thing is you wanna make sure your body's in a straight line, and you don't wanna have your feet too far forward, your hips too far back, or anything like that. Straight line from the skull to the toes. Okay, you're gonna make sure the elbow is stacked underneath the shoulders, and you're gonna have your head nice and strong here, core nice and tight. You're gonna lift the hips up off the ground. You can put this other hand on your side, anywhere really that feels comfortable for you. And this one you'll actually hold for about 20 seconds, and then you'll relax right back down. It's pretty standard, but it's really important that you keep your abs really tight on this one and you don't allow your hips to sag too low. If that's pretty challenging for you, you can bend this bottom knee and actually push up through the knee and do it that way. It's a little bit shorter of a lever. It's gonna be a little bit easier for you, and then you can eventually build up to maybe having both legs straight. But as long as you're getting that activation through the obliques, that's one really big thing there.